It is 7 o'clock. Good to see you this morning. It seems there is a little seasonal cheer within the Conservative Party. Boris Johnson is facing anger from his own MPs after hastily enforcing a switch to his plan B for COVID restrictions. All this as the row over an alleged rule-breaking Christmas party at Number 10 continues. The Health Secretary, Sajid Javid, was heckled by Tory backbenchers as he outlined his plans to combat the threat from Omicron. We'll be sitting down with him together in just a few moments' time. But also ahead on the programme, the England Rugby Union coach, Eddie Jones, he'll be joining us to discuss his new book, revealing the secrets behind his success. Also ahead... why this year's hit pantomime is a Muslim take on a Christmas classic. It is Thursday, the 9th of December. A credibility crisis. Conservative pressure on the PM over his switch to Plan B and that Christmas party row.
Anyone who says there wasn't a party but knew about it and said in Parliament there was no party has misled Parliament, and that is a serious charge, and you cannot continue in the highest office in the land if you've done that.
A COVID crash. The NHS Pass app goes offline following the announcement. It'll become mandatory for some English venues next week. Basement Blues. The Conservatives admit another illegal Christmas party took place, this time at their head office last December. Royal Connection. The trial of Ghislaine Maxwell hears how she and Jeffrey Epstein visited the Queen's Balmoral estate. As for the weather, rain spreading in from the west after a fine and frosty start in places. Morning all, and it is the morning after the day before, but it is unlikely Boris Johnson is waking up with a clear head. An apology over a leaked video showing Number 10 staff laughing about an alleged rule-breaking party, and a hasty switch to Plan B to stave off the spread of the Omicron variant. Those have done little to quell the discontent among his own backbenchers. The Health Secretary was himself heckled by Tory MPs as he outlined the measures in the Commons. We'll be hearing from him in just a moment. But first, let's remind you as to the new rules for England. From tomorrow, face masks will be required in more public settings, including theatres and cinemas. From Monday, people will be asked to work from home where possible. Next Wednesday, the NHS COVID pass will also be required for nightclubs, indoor unseated venues with more than 500 people, unseated outdoor venues with more than 4,000 people, and any event with more than 10,000 attending. Overnight, the NHS app crashed for several hours as people tried to access their vaccine certificates. But the Prime Minister says that parties and nativity plays should still go ahead so long as the guidance is followed. Here's our chief political correspondent, John Craig.
We will be introducing mandatory certification based on vaccines or tests.
Shouts of disgraceful and resign have Sajid Javid announced COVID Plan B in the Commons. Not from opposition MPs, but from Conservative backbenchers. A warning of a big Tory rebellion when MPs vote on the measures next week. In a 24-hour U-turn, Boris Johnson triggered COVID curbs, including working from home, face masks in more places, and vaccine passports for nightclubs and large events.
It's now the proportionate and the responsible thing to move to Plan B in England while continuing to work closely with our colleagues in the devolved administrations so we slow the spread of the virus.
But despite an apology and an inquiry, the Prime Minister finds himself engulfed in a scandal over a Downing Street party that has led to the charge that he's taking the public for fools. A Sky News poll suggests only 12% think he's telling the truth about the party.
It is quite clear that the Prime Minister has lied regularly and repeatedly about the Downing Street parties and sent his own ministers out to lie on his behalf. This has undermined public trust and confidence in the Prime Minister, in his government, but even worse, in the public health measures and public health message at a critical time.
After a tearful resignation by Number 10 spokeswoman Allegra Stratton, who appeared in a video joking about the party...
I went home.
Senior Tories also turned up the heat on the PM.
Anyone who says there wasn't a party but knew about it and said in Parliament there was no party has misled Parliament, and that is a serious charge, and you cannot continue in the highest office in the land if you've done that.
The problem facing the Prime Minister as he brings in new rules on face masks and vaccine passports is that MPs, including many on his own side, are now saying, how can he expect the public to obey the new rules when people here inside this building appear to have been breaking the rules?
There's no danger of the government losing next week's vote on Plan B, since Labour has pledged to support the measures.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
But the PM is facing a major crisis over his credibility and even calls to resign. John Craig, Sky News.
Well, overnight, the Conservatives have admitted they did host another illegal party last Christmas. An event was held by the team running the campaign for the Conservative candidate for London Mayor, Sean Bailey. That party was held at the Conservative Party headquarters in December last year. In a statement, Conservative officials said they were aware of what they called an unauthorised social gathering in the basement and that disciplinary action had been taken. Very pleased to say that we're joined once again on the programme by the Health Secretary, Sajid Javid. Mr Javid, great to see you this morning. And, of course, there is plenty to talk about in terms of parties, but let's start on your brief and with that, the changes to the public health strategy. Clearly, there is an awful lot of concern in government about the spread of Omicron right now. Why are we so concerned?
Of this new variant, our strategy has been to buy time to assess it and also to build our protective defences. In recent days, we've started learning more about the variant, and one of those things we've learned is that it spreads very, very quickly. It spreads faster than any other COVID variant we've seen so far. It's doubling time. That's the number of days it takes, the number of infections take to double in the community. We estimate is between 2.5 to 3 days, which would mean, at that rate, by the end of this month, we could hit about 1 million infections in the community throughout the UK. And we've always been clear that should the data change, and should it move in the wrong direction and it look like that the NHS might come under unsustainable pressure. And remember what that would mean. We wouldn't be able to get emergency care, not just for COVID, you know, for a car accident or anything like that. We would act and implement Plan B. Now, I don't enjoy doing that. No one does. You know, it's a very difficult thing for many people, asking them to work from home or wearing face masks and things. It's a real impact on our liberties. But I hope that most people will understand that by taking some decisive action now, we can potentially avoid action later. And then just on that, our vaccines and our antivirals also remain a very important part of our defences.
The key word, I suspect, in all of that is potentially. We do not yet know whether or not the boosters plus Plan B will, in and of themselves, be enough to halt the spread of Omicron. If they're not, what next?
Look, we don't have all the answers on Omicron yet. We've been very clear about this. Not just us, throughout the world, many countries are still trying to learn more. But what we do know is by implementing Plan B, so the rules around working from home, the face mask rules, the rule around the COVID passport, that will mean that we can slow the incursion of this, slow the spread of this, and it buys us time to build our defences. And the booster is key because, although it's possible, and again, it's a possibility that the efficacy of vaccines may be impacted by Omicron, and there's some data to suggest that, it is still the case that by boosting, you're going to get a lot more protection than otherwise. We're doing incredibly well as a country with boosters, over 20 million.
All accepted, but it is the case, isn't it, that over the Christmas period, there will be increased mixing, unless, of course, there is a change to the plans for Christmas. That is, in and of itself, likely to lead to increased spread. Is it the case that, you know, come January, we could be looking at even more significant measures being brought in?
No, I hope not. And I think the action we've taken now is very decisive. I think it's going to make a big difference. And as I say, it's not something that anyone would do lightly. It has a real impact on people. It will be difficult for many people. But I think that, and I hope most people would understand, it's better to take this action now than to see the rate of spread increase.
Is the government considering mandatory vaccination? I mean, the Prime Minister did appear to hint at that when he suggested a national conversation about mandatory vaccination. What's the truth of that?
I've got no interest in mandatory vaccination, apart from the high-risk settings in the NHS and social care, which we've already set out that we will legislate for. Other than that, if you're talking about universal mandatory vaccination, I think ethically it's wrong, but also at a very practical level, it just wouldn't work. You know, sure. Getting vaccinated has to be a positive decision.
Feels like we can park that one then, but just in terms of the hospitality sector, slightly away from your brief, but will we see additional support for hospitality because they are already starting to lose money as a result of these Plan B changes?
Well, the measures we've taken under the, you know, the Plan B, although they have an impact, they're designed to have a minimal impact. So whether it's wearing face masks, exempting hospitality from certain of the measures on the COVID pass,
this sounds like a no for more financial support for.
Well, we'll keep that under review, right. But the measures are designed to have this minimal impact.
Let us discuss the events of the past couple of days. We were expecting to see you sitting in that chair yesterday morning. Kay Burley was very, very upset that you didn't appear. Why wasn't there a government minister on the media rounds yesterday?
Well, I didn't appear because I saw that video, the video you just played again. It upset me. It upset a lot of people, I think, across the country. It upset the Prime Minister.
Did you refuse to come on yesterday?
No, it wasn't about refusing. I spoke to my colleagues in Number 10 and I said, look, you know, we actually agreed that it's best to have some time to respond to the video in the way that the Prime Minister has now by ordering an investigation by the Cabinet Secretary. And so I think the idea was just to give them space to react. But I'm pleased the Prime Minister has asked for an investigation. And I can see also why so many people would have been upset by that video.
Totally. But will you now be the First Minister to accept, on a balance of probabilities, that an event probably did take place in December on that date and that rules were probably broken?
Look, the truth is, I don't know. I have received assurances, like the Prime Minister has, that all rules will follow throughout the pandemic at all times.
Who is providing those reassurances? Because we've heard this from government ministers sitting where you are all this week. We've heard it countless times from the Prime Minister. I have been told, I have been reassured. Who is saying
this? Well, I'm not going to get into names, but you know, senior people have assured me that rules have been followed. But I also think the Prime Minister...
Did no one think to check this?
The Prime Minister, I think, has acted completely correctly yesterday to order an investigation and to find out, you know, what may or may not have happened, and to have that investigation done by the Cabinet Secretary, who's free to look wherever he wishes, speak to whoever he wants,
sure.
Look at any potential event that may or may not have happened.
But we saw the Prime Minister yesterday at PMQs accusing Keir Starmer of playing politics in all of this. The Prime Minister, at any point over the last 7 days, could have opened up the door to his office, popped outside, asked people what went on that date, and discovered for himself. The reason he hasn't done so, and you and I both know this to be the case, is that it's politically expedient for the Prime Minister to not know what went on in Number 10. If that's not playing politics with the situation, what is?
No, I don't accept that. And the reason is because what we heard from the Prime Minister yesterday is that he's asked for an investigation by the Cabinet Secretary.
Mm-hmm.
The Cabinet Secretary has a lot of authority, and that he can speak to whoever he wishes and find out what really happened. And I think the best way to look into this is to get the Cabinet Secretary, use all his authority to find out what really happened.
But presumably the Cabinet Secretary was one of those reassuring the Prime Minister that no rules had been broken. I mean, surely that would have been the first person he would have asked.
Well, I wasn't even in government at that time, so I don't know who may have given the PM that reassurance or not, but I think it is important that this investigation that's going on.
Well, because he's either been misled or someone has lied to him, because, as you noted, the video itself pretty clearly demonstrates two very senior figures in Downing Street, one of whom has now departed, conceding that a party took place, accepting the fact that rules were probably broken, and more than that, then going on to war game a potential response. The video is prima facie evidence that a party took place. I'm just wondering why the Prime Minister has taken so long to reach that conclusion.
Well, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would take into account what's on that video, the people that were in that room at the time, but it's right the Cabinet Secretary is given the time to do that and get to the bottom of this.
But just in terms of that investigation by the Cabinet Secretary, what faith can any of us have that the Prime Minister will follow the results of that investigation? The last time there was an investigation by a senior member of the civil service, the head of ethics for the civil service, into Priti Patel and bullying, the Prime Minister read it and then discarded it.
Well, the investigation is taking place. I don't want to preempt the outcome of it, but I know that Simon Case is a very professional, very serious person, very independent.
So too was the head of ethics for the civil service.
But let's see what comes out of the investigation.
There is a pattern of behaviour here. Why is the investigation only focusing on the party that took place in Downing Street on the 18th, not the party that took place on the 13th of November in his flat, not the party that took place on November the 27th at which the Prime Minister spoke, the party that took place at the Department for Education, the party that took place at CCHQ. Why is the investigation only focused on the one thing that the Prime Minister can guarantee he wasn't attending?
It's not. My understanding is that Simon Case and his team can look at any aspect of any potential event that may or may not have happened at number 10, including my understanding again is that he will be looking into the what happened at the Department for Education as well.
Why did Allegra Stratton resign?
Honestly, I don't know. And I do know Allegra. I think she's an outstanding spokesperson. She's done some fantastic work on the COP recently, that conference. And I think just by listening to her statement yesterday, I think she felt bad about what had happened and the way things looked.
Well, she apologised for the joke. On which basis? Why is Ed Oldfield still in his position? He was there. He was joking. Why is Jacob Rees-Mogg still leader of the House? He was joking at an Institute for Fiscal Studies event that happened the past couple of days.
Look, I think that we should just let this investigation happen and get to the facts, and Simon Case is the person to do that.
Do you not understand, though, the level of frustration that there is in this government at the moment? Because, on the one hand, we have been told for over a week now that no party took place. Yesterday, Downing Street refused to repeat that denial. The only thing that has changed is that video has emerged which shows that a party took place and that rules were broken. That is the only thing that has changed. I mean, are you taking the public for fools in all of this? The reason, presumably, Allegra Stratton resigned, it's not because of the joke, but because the government has been caught in the cover-up.
I just said to you at the start of this, but you asked me, why didn't I appear? Why wasn't I sitting here yesterday? Mm-hmm. It's because I saw that video. I found it very upsetting to see what was on that video, the laughing, the sniggering and things. And I think most people did across the country. And that's the way I reacted. And now the Prime Minister has reacted by asking for an investigation. I'm pleased he's done that. But of course I understand how people feel, what they might think and what they're seeing. And I do think we need to get to the bottom of it. And the way to do that is to have this investigation that the Cabinet Secretary is leading.
Do you, though, accept that there is a real problem in terms of trust in this government? The simple fact is that no one believes you. No one believes you when you say that there was no party in number 10, not you specifically, but the government, that no rules were broken. Fewer than one in 10 believe number 10's claim that no party took place in Downing Street. And this follows on from a number of other occasions over the past 12, 24 months where the government have said X is going to happen and then it doesn't, or promise Y and then it doesn't appear. I mean, the list of occasions on which this government has performed a U-turn: free school meals, the reopening of primary schools, mandatory face coverings in shops, face masks in schools, A-levels, second lockdown, furlough extension, cancelling of Christmas, the Northern Ireland Protocol, vaccine passports. You've performed a U-turn on all of this. Isn't it objectively reasonable for people now to distrust everything that this government says?
I think it's unfair to really conflate all of that. I understand the anger about the video, as I've shared with you my own anger and concern about that. But the other issues that you mentioned, I mean, these are all important issues. But, for example, you just mentioned, COVID passports or face masks and things. It is right that we have a flexible response to the pandemic.
All of this when made it, your job when
things,
hasn't it?
When things have improved the pandemic, as we saw, we made the right decisions to open up in the summer. We've been really fortunate as a country with the work the NHS has done around our vaccination effort. Fantastic effort. We've got more people vaccinated than most other countries.
But all of
We've
this has made your job more difficult,
booster program.
Hasn't it?
Well, I'm getting on with my job. And the important thing is, right here and now, as far as I'm concerned, is that the pandemic is still there. We need to keep boosting and building our defences. We need to learn more about new variants. And we need to make the difficult decisions to help protect the country. And that's what I'm going to be focused on. And can I just finally say, if I may, that if any of you, if they get the call from the NHS to get vaccinated, particularly the booster, please turn up and roll up your sleeve and get protected.
Well, we saw the efforts that you went to with John Craig. I'm sure the public will be paying.
Yeah, he's well boosted.
Indeed. Health Secretary, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Well, let's quickly get the paper's take on the story, starting with the FT. Boris Johnson adopts Plan B to check virus as anger festers over parties. The Eye. says that Boris Johnson rushed in new COVID restrictions in England after an outcry over Downing Street staff joking about breaching lockdown restrictions. Prime Minister is taking the public for fools, the Metro's headline. It says the Prime Minister is facing growing calls to quit. The Telegraph says that Boris Johnson has told people to work from home, yet said they can still have office Christmas parties, prompting suggestions the new rules were somewhat illogical. And The Guardian reports that Labour reports Labour claims that Mr Johnson has lost moral authority. Still to come on the programme this morning. Well, as the government introduces further COVID restrictions in England, we'll be discussing how we're doing in the fight against Omicron. Has the government mishandled allegations of a Downing Street party or seen off a crisis? We'll be discussing that with the former Downing Street Director of Communications, Jonathan Haslam. And we'll also hear claims that the NHS is being pushed to breaking point by demands for child mental health services. Over the next few days, anyone working in an office, running a city centre business or going to a concert in England will see some pretty substantial changes. Sky's Shingi Marariki has been taking a closer look.
For almost 44 years, this pie shop in Reading has been dishing out handmade delights. After struggling through the pandemic, the news customers will once again be asked to work from home comes as yet another blow to business.
Each day we get a phone call for cancellations. We've had almost 150 cancelled in the last few days. At the moment, the people who are in the offices, yes, we do get them in, especially in our little retail shop for takeaway. Obviously, that will slow that down dramatically at lunchtimes.
The government's plan B, brought in to stop the spread of the Omicron variant, will also see mandatory mask wearing in places like theatres and cinemas, while vaccine passports will be needed for nightclubs and large venues.
From next week, clubbing in places like here, Leicester Square, will look very different. Drinking, dancing and having a good time will come with a slice of precaution in the form of a mandatory vaccine passport.
The new rules were supported by these concert goers in North London.
Why not just get it? It costs nothing. There you go. It's keeping people safe.
I'm vaccinated. I think everyone should be that goes to a gig.
I've got some underlying health conditions as well, so I think knowing that everything's in place is a lot better for me and my anxiety. So, I feel a lot more confident going out now.
But the chief executive for the Nighttime Industries Association says restrictions are a hammer blow for the sector.
We're in a very fragile state and we need as much support as possible. And that comes, you know, both from a financial position as well as a confidence position from government. We've done an amazing job since the 19th of July, and the government should have confidence that we have delivered everything we said we'd deliver in terms of these mitigations. So further restrictions are a real blow for us as an industry.
It's usually a time for celebration, but with COVID cases on the rise, the festivities we used to take for granted will look very different. Shingi Marariki, Sky News.
Abolex Brigade Sky's Charlotte Lomas, who's with commuters at Gerrard's Cross in Buckinghamshire. Morning, Charlotte. You've got to imagine that plenty of those who'll be getting on the train this morning might not be getting on the train come Monday.
That's right, Neil. I'll be actually talking to some of the commuters here in Gerrard's Cross as they are running for their train this morning. Many of them won't be doing that come Monday morning. There's a real mix of mood among the commuters here. Some that I've been talking to are angry at having to return to working from home. Others just feel essentially that it's the rules and that they will have to comply despite being disappointed. Many people have just got back into the swing of office life and enjoying doing that. There's also the business side to all of this. Many businesses are angry at having to take that step back, and some unions calling for furlough to be reintroduced to help support those people. But really, as of Plan B coming back, this will be the main change affecting most people, with the government ordering many of us to return to working from home. And it really is to try and stop that rapid spread of the variant Omicron. We know we've heard from the scientific advisory group SAGE warning that the doubling time of this virus is 2 to 3 days. So you can really clearly see that things could get very bad very quickly. And that's why the government wants to impose these restrictions.
Charlotte, for now, thanks very much indeed. Well, let's ourselves take a quick look at the latest daily COVID data. And there have been 51,342 new cases recorded in the last 24 hours. Another 161 deaths have been reported within 28 days of a positive test. That brings the total number of deaths in the UK to 145,987. Meanwhile, 23,512 people received their first dose of a vaccine, while 28,375 received their second. That takes the total number of second doses to 46.6 million. What of boosters, third jabs? Well, 391,050 of those were given in the latest 24-hour period, meaning the total number of booster and third doses is ahead of 21.3 million. Also this morning, the Australian Deputy Prime Minister has tested positive for coronavirus just days after a visit to the UK. Barnaby Joyce was forced to go into isolation after arriving in the United States. Mr. Joyce told Sky News Australia he may have contracted the virus while he was in Britain.
Look, in the UK, I must admit, it's crowded Christmas shopping and, you know, you wouldn't know there was a pandemic on in many areas of the UK. People are just shoulder to shoulder. And so, you know, there's a heap of areas you could possibly get it.
Despite a major operation by the US Coast Guard, a woman has died after her car crashed into the river near Niagara Falls. Search and rescue teams did manage to reach the car just metres from the edge. A body of a woman in her 60s was recovered from the vehicle. The New Zealand government has revealed plans to stop young people smoking. From 2027, it plans to make it illegal for anyone aged 14 to ever buy tobacco in their life. Now, if it comes into force, it would be one of the most strict anti-smoking laws in the world. Time for a quick look at the weather.
Look forward to brighter skies. The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
It will be calmer than recently, but rain will spread from the west on strengthening winds. Currently, mostly calm, dry and clear with a patchy frost, but there are some mainly coastal showers in the north. The west of Ireland is pretty wet. The UK will stay mostly fine through the morning, with early showers becoming confined to northern Scotland. But northern Ireland and the southwest will turn wet. Ireland will see the rain in the west clearing into northern and eastern parts.
The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
Coming up after the break, we'll be discussing the fight against Omicron and the new COVID restrictions in England with the epidemiologist Andrew Hayward. That's coming next. Welcome back. The Health Secretary says he was upset when he first saw a leaked video of Downing Street staff laughing about an alleged party held during lockdown. Boris Johnson has apologised for the incident last December, but Conservative MPs have joined the opposition in demanding a further explanation.
I saw that video. I found it very upsetting to see what was on that video, the laughing, the sniggering and things. And I think most people did across the country. And that's the way I reacted. And now the Prime Minister has reacted by asking for an investigation. I'm pleased he's done that. But of course, I understand how people feel, what they might think and what they're seeing. And I do think we need to get to the bottom of it. And the way to do that is to have this investigation that the Cabinet Secretary is leading.
Well, Sajid Javid also warned that the UK could see a million cases of the Omicron strain of coronavirus. He says, we're still learning about how the latest variant spreads.
In recent days, we've started learning more about the variant. And one of those things we've learned is that it spreads very, very quickly. It spreads faster than any other COVID variant we've seen so far. It's doubling time. That's the number of days it takes, the number of infections take to double in the community. We estimate is between 2.5 to 3 days, which would mean at that rate, by the end of this month, we could hit about 1 million infections in the community throughout the UK.
Our political correspondent, Rob Powell, is on duty for us this morning. Good to see you, Rob. Well, there are two aspects to all of this, but both of them piling pressure on the government. Clearly, the concerns about the Omicron variant, but no matter how much we try, the government tries to bat off this to a cabinet secretary investigation, there are still plenty of questions to ask about a party that, frankly, everyone now assumes took place and everyone assumes broke the rules.
Yeah, I think on those sort of points around health policy, if you like, I thought an alarming picture being painted by the health secretary, and when you asked whether we could see more restrictions in January after Christmas mixing, all he said to that was, well, I hope not, which isn't terribly reassuring. Interesting as well, coming pretty close to ruling out compulsory vaccination after the PM appeared to float that idea last night. So quite strong on that. I think on the issue of the party, the effect that these investigations and calling an investigation by the cabinet secretary have is they act like a bit of a political fire blanket for ministers facing interviews, because any time they get questions about it, they can just say, look, we need to wait for the investigation to play out. And whilst he did go fairly far in saying he was upset by the sniggering in that video, on the actual facts and what that video really does seem to suggest, that something was going on that night in Number 10 that was not completely within the rules, he just wouldn't be drawn on it, saying that he didn't know why Allegra Stratton had resigned, when I think even though she didn't make reference to the party in her statement, it seems pretty clear as day to most people that if everything was above board on December the 18th, there would have probably been no need for her to resign. So really not giving much at all on that and just saying wait for the inquiry. The political danger for the Prime Minister, though, is that this morning there were reports or confirmation from the Conservative Party of another event that took place in Tory HQ. There are accusations of an event that the Prime Minister went to, of parties going on in the Prime Ministerial flat as well. And if more details around them come out, that's when it starts to get very, very sticky for the government.
Certainly does. Rob, for now, thanks very much indeed. Well, as we've been reporting, the Prime Minister says that the spread of the Omicron variant will lead to a big rise in the number of people in hospital and therefore the number of lives lost. Official figures suggest that cases are doubling every 3 days. Worrying indeed. Joining us now, Andrew Hayward, Director of UCL's Institute of Epidemiology and Healthcare, and a member of NERVTAG, the new Emerging Respiratory Virus Threats Advisory Group. Good to see you again this morning, Andrew. Let us just start with that which we heard from the Prime Minister yesterday. The move to Plan B coming perhaps slightly earlier than some had anticipated. What do you make of it?
Well, I think the virus is moving very fast, so it's important that we react to that fast. As you say, this doubling time of 2 to 3 times every 2 to 3 days is very fast. And if we think about, we've had very high levels of the Delta variant for about 6 months now, but it's been at a sort of steady rate. I think the scary thing about this is that because it's going up so fast, you'll get a very large peak. And it's a bit like if you think of a month's worth of rain falling in a few days, that leads to flooding. And it's a similar type of scenario. And so, fortunately, we can reduce that by reducing social mixing and allow time to slow the virus down and get vaccine into more people's arms.
I mean, as you've mentioned, there is still so much about Omicron that we do not yet know. But on the basis of that which we do, is Plan B sufficient to slow the spread?
It will slow the spread. It's not going to turn it around. I think you would need much, much more severe restrictions to turn it around. But I think what the encouraging thing is that we've started to see through some of the laboratory data is that that third dose of vaccine is really providing much better immunity, whereas just with the two doses, it's not really so good. So this idea of slowing it down first with what we can do quickly, which is the more social distancing, not going to work if you don't have to, not going on public transport to go to work when you don't have to, that will make a difference. I mean, I think it's very difficult to predict whether that's going to be enough, but I think it's an essential first move here.
Andrew, then, just in terms, though, again, of that which we do not know about Omicron, in terms of the symptoms that it causes, there is some data that suggests that it may well be milder than other variants, but that increased transmissibility alone will mean increased hospitalizations and increased deaths.
Yes, I think that's right. And I think we shouldn't overplay our knowledge about the severity at the moment. So far, it's been mainly in a young adult population. We haven't really seen what it's going to do in an older population. So that's one thing. But then even if the severity was reduced to a moderate or to even quite a large extent, if you've got many-fold more cases at one time than you would have done, then that's when you're going to get this flood of cases in the NHS. And the NHS doesn't have a huge amount of capacity. For example, you know, if we compare ourselves to Germany, we've got less than half the amount of hospital beds, so we haven't got that much to play with.
Andrew Hayward, great to have you on the programme this morning. Thanks for joining us. Now, the allegations of illegal Conservative Christmas parties continue this morning. The party has admitted an event was held by the team running the campaign for the Conservative candidate for London Mayor, Sean Bailey, at party headquarters last December. But are they now getting on top of the scandal? Joining us on the programme, Jonathan Haslam, former Downing Street Communications Director for John Major. Jonathan, lovely to see you again. Let us start, shall we, with the firefighting strategy that appears to be taking the government at the moment. Has the Prime Minister's position been made more secure by the announcement of an investigation into a party that, you know, just a couple of days ago, the Prime Minister was insisting, did not happen and that no rules had been broken?
Good morning, Neil. I think he's bought some extra time, but the strategy still seems to me to be one that's being made up on the hoof. And I'll be very surprised if at the end of this we're not seeing one or two other people departing from Downing Street and burnishing their CVs over the Christmas period. It really doesn't seem to stack up too much. There has to be a very clear explanation from Simon Case about what happened. And the public certainly isn't in a mood to accept sophistry around how you define a party and how you define a gathering and some sort of clever wheeze that might get the government out of trouble. You may recall that there was some time ago when both Boris Johnson and Rishi Sunak were tested positive for COVID, and there was a brief hours period when suddenly Downing Street and number 11 and 12 were designated as areas where actually you could try out not isolating. And that crashed to earth fairly quickly. This is pretty serious stuff because the Prime Minister's on the House, in the House. He said on the record that there wasn't a party. He has said that's how he was being briefed. But the public must be fed up to the back teeth with all of this nonsense. There are too many serious things happening with COVID that you've just been discussing with another expert, as well as an international sphere when we see 100,000 troops on Ukraine's border. And we want our government to be able to concentrate full-heartedly on that, not the shenanigans of people who think they can break rules with impunity and joke about it on video. So the strategy for me seems to be at least a week late and only about 10% of what should be done.
Jonathan, you suggested there may well be more resignations to follow that of Allegra Stratton, and I think there'll be plenty of people who agree with you. But just in terms of her resignation, do you accept her statement on her front steps yesterday at face value that she resigned because of the joke that she was making? Or do you feel, as others do, that Allegra Stratton has resigned because she was pictured in a video which confirms that the party did take place and that senior figures in Number 10 knew that it had probably broken rules?
We won't know entirely until somebody speaks to her. And you and I have followed politics and been associated with it for a very long time, we tend to be cynical and flinty-hearted about this.
No, Jonathan, come on.
While I saw that, I'm sure you're kinder than I am, while I saw that, Allegra was clearly distressed on her doorstep, I also noted that a statement given in that fashion without the opportunity to put a question to her was very clear. So there was some manipulation going on in that regard as well. So where we are at the moment is a completely dysfunctional Downing Street with nobody seeming to have a grip. Chaos is not a management theory that you can apply in government. And the public at this very difficult time really needs to know there is strong, determined, integrated and intellectually coherent arguments for asking us to undergo yet more restrictions on our ways of life. And we can understand it. We'll go with it. But at the moment, the Prime Minister is resting heavily on Whitty and Valance and their credibility and the needs of the National Health Service. This isn't tenable. And actually, I do wait to see when the government, in terms of its cabinet, is actually going to step up and start holding the Prime Minister to account. He might be promis inter pares, but he's not a dictator. But it appears that he seems to have impunity at the moment. There are too many questions still unanswered, Neil.
Indeed. Just briefly, if you can, how difficult is the job of government when, as it appears, the opinion poll suggesting that people are just now starting not to believe what this government says anymore?
It's very difficult because you're asking people to do things that naturally they don't want to do. And we're a pretty long-suffering nation overall, and we will go and accept some of these restrictions on our lives. But there will come a point when actually it'll show, as it already is in the polls, and the politicians will start to wake up. So watch for the Chief Whip going into Number 10 to have a quiet word with the Prime Minister. Watch for Graham Brady saying, actually, you need to step up. This game is just not good enough. You need to change it. You know, it's a bit like Manchester United under Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. Sooner or later, you've got to change or you accept that you're just going to be in a team of mediocrity, which is entirely wrong for a country of our standing.
And entirely wrong for a team like Manchester United. Jonathan Haslam, good to see you this morning. Thanks very much for joining us. Now, pictures shown at the trial of Ghislaine Maxwell show her with the disgraced billionaire Jeffrey Epstein at the Queen's Balmoral Estate. The pictures appear to show the extent of Maxwell's closeness with Epstein, who took his own life while awaiting sex trafficking charges. Our US correspondent Martha Kellner has the detail.
They appear on some of the photos like any other loving couple, documenting a life of luxury lived together. A ski trip, a tight embrace, even a visit, it seems, to the Queen's Balmoral Estate, pictured in the same spot where Her Majesty has been photographed. But these pictures, including those taken aboard Jeffrey Epstein's private plane, are now evidence in a sex trafficking trial, which could see Ghislaine Maxwell spend the rest of her life in prison. The prosecution argues they show not only romantic partners, but partners in crime. They were found on CDs and hard drives, seized during a police raid of Epstein's New York mansion, stored inside wardrobes and a safe. Also found was this advert, apparently created by Maxwell, calling for a massage therapist. Much of Epstein's abusing is said to have centred around massages. The prosecution's case is that Ghislaine Maxwell and Jeffrey Epstein's lives were very much intertwined, that while they may have started out as boyfriend and girlfriend, Ghislaine Maxwell soon became much more than that. One witness described her as Epstein's second in command. David Rogers, a former pilot for Epstein, was asked where Ms. Maxwell sat in the hierarchy. She would be number two, he said. Below whom, the prosecutor asked. He responded, Jeffrey Epstein. The prosecution is expected to rest its case today, having perhaps saved their strongest witness for last. Annie Farmer is the only alleged victim testifying to have waived her anonymity. It will then be the defence's turn to argue that Ghislaine Maxwell is not the handmaiden to sex abuse she's being portrayed as. Martha Kellner, Sky News, New York.
Stay right where you are. After the break, I'll be discussing those claims that the demand for child mental health services is pushing the health service to breaking point. That's next. Now, MPs on the Health and Social Care Committee and a panel of experts say that mental health provision is being pushed to breaking point by growing demands for mental health care for youngsters and children. Joining us now on the programme, Professor Dame Jane Dacre, who chairs that expert panel assessing the government's progress in child mental health. Professor Dacre, great to have you on the programme this morning. I wonder if we can just start with a very general question. Just how stretched, how overstretched, in fact, is mental health care for our young people?
Well, mental health care is overstretched for all of our people. The expert panel that I chair looked at mental health care in the round, and it included children and young people. And what we did was gather evidence both from patients and also from doctors and other healthcare workers. And we compared that to government data and other data that we could find. And we gave ratings for the mental health pledges that the government had made and found that in all areas it requires improvement. That includes children and young people. And the main problem was that access to mental health care wasn't as good as it should have been, or wasn't as good as it had been promised to be. And also when young people have a crisis, that crisis is not dealt with as efficiently as it should be. So it is worrying. It's not only worrying for children, though. Our expert panel reports show that it's worrying for everybody with mental health problems.
To what extent, then, Professor, can we generalise and suggest that these additional pressures on mental health care provision flow directly from the pandemic? I mean, there can't be one of us that hasn't, over the past, 18 months, had a bit of a wobble, myself included. We've all had to think a little bit more carefully about our mental health. Luckily, I work for an organisation where I can pick up the phone and get help if I need so. Other people are not quite so lucky.
Well, interestingly, our work judged pledges that started to be made pre-pandemic. And what is a bit disheartening is that the pledges were not on track to be met before the pandemic even started. So the pandemic has undoubtedly made things worse. It doesn't alter what we found in our work, though, because we deliberately excluded the influence of the pandemic from our judgments. But there is no doubt that during the pandemic, there's been an increase in people having concerns about their well-being. And there is a debate about how much of that is actually legitimate concern. However, some of that concern has gone on to become significant mental illness or mental health problems.
It has been some time since I can first recall the government talking about parity of esteem between physical health care and mental health care. Judging by your report, we are a country mile away from achieving that goal of parity of esteem.
We haven't achieved parity of esteem. And although a number of the pledges that have been put in were very well founded and hoped to achieve parity of esteem, sadly, the mental health workforce doesn't have the skills and expertise amongst its staff to be able to institute the treatments that are necessary. Another pledge which wasn't met was the idea of having physical health checks for patients with mental illness. And again, that hasn't been met. So we have a bit of a way to go to achieve parity of esteem. Now, this is not to undermine the sterling efforts of those that work in mental health services, and indeed those that are leading the work in mental health services, who've actually done an extremely good job at working on improving things. It's just that they came from behind. There's a long way to go to catch up. And the pledges that have been made for the moment are just not achievable.
Professor Dame Jane Dacre, chair of that expert panel evaluating the government's progress against its commitments to mental health. Great to have you on the programme this morning. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And you lot can stay exactly where you are. Still to come, we will, of course, reflect on that interview with the Health Secretary about the move to Plan B, somewhat abrupt move to Plan B, and, of course, those Christmas parties. But we'll also be speaking to the Labour Deputy Leader, Angela Rayner. She'll be here. Well, she'll be phoning us in to give us her take on the allegations of a party in Downing Street and, indeed, the government's public health response to Omicron. All that coming up after this.